You're listening to the Straight to Video Podcast with Rob Lane.
Welcome along to my show, Straight to Video. How's it going out there? And as ever, I'm your host, Rob Lane. And today is a treat as I get the opportunity to welcome singer-songwriter Curtis Stigers to the podcast. Some of you will perhaps know Curtis from his massive hits in the early 90s, which hit the top 10 here in the UK with I Wonder Why and You're All That Matters to Me from his worldwide smash hit debut album. Alternatively, some of you will know him from the song This Life, which was the theme to the hit TV series Sons of Anarchy. Perhaps one of the greatest theme songs of recent years and one that you do not hit skip on when binge watching that incredible show. Today, Curtis continues to write, record, and tour on his own terms since stepping away from the big record company machines of the past, and is set to release his new album, This Life, which includes reworkings of songs from throughout his career. The album is described as a celebration of three decades of musical exploration, evolution, and growth. It's a look back at 13 albums, thousands of concert performances, and millions of miles on the road. Now, it was an absolute treat to chat to Curtis all about this and his career from his very early days in California before moving to Idaho, where he would begin performing in small jazz clubs, then relocating to New York City and landing the record deal which would forever change his life. Before we get into today's chat, though, please spare a second to visit our friends Dead School Coffee, who are regular supporters of this podcast and are offering you 15% off their fantastic ground or full bean coffee. Simply head on over to deadschoolcoffee.co.uk and use the promo code STV to grab that discount and know that you're supporting a real independent rock and roll company. Curtis Stigers will be undertaking a residency at the world-famous Ronnie Scott's Club in London at the end of February and will be returning for a full UK tour through March and April. All dates along with information on the new album This Life can be found over at curtisstigers.com. But for now, please enjoy my straight-to-video chat with Curtis Stigers.
When the snows come and the wind blows cold, will you hold me like you'll never let go? Will you kiss me so sweetly and promise you'll love me so? 'Cause I have wandered through the mountains, I have searched the streets below, and all I ever really wanted is someone to hold me and to keep me from the cold.
There we go.
How you doing, sir?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good, Kurt. It's lovely to see you.
And you.
I'm coming to you from just outside Nottingham, so right smack bang in the middle.
I'm in Boise, Idaho.
You've come kind of full circle to Boise, right?
Yeah, I moved back here quite a while ago. My daughter was born in 2000 in New York, and it didn't make sense to raise a kid there. So in 2003, I moved back. So I've been here for, been back for about 17 years, 18 years now.
You spent the early years of your childhood in Temple City, I believe, just outside Hollywood. What are some of your earliest memories of that area during the early 70s? Did any of that California lifestyle get in your blood before you moved away?
Wow, Temple City, you've done your homework. Yeah, Temple City is sort of east of East LA. Actually, not that close to Hollywood. I was born in a hospital on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood. So I say that I was born there, but really it was just where the hospital was. I remember driving around a lot. That's what you did in Southern California. I mean, I think you always do. But back in the 70s, so much of my time was spent driving around with my mom in a car, listening to the radio. So I learned a lot about music just from driving around LA, listening to pop radio. And back then on pop radio, you could hear Neil Young and Joni Mitchell and Gordon Lightfoot on the same station as Gladys Knight and the Pips and Stevie Wonder, and on the same station as Led Zeppelin and Deep Purple. I mean, they played everything on pop radio. So I became a fan of so many different types of music. And once I became a musician, I wanted to learn to play. a lot of different types of music. It didn't occur to me to just do one thing and just love one type of music.
So you've fallen in love with music whilst in California, because I think you said one of your first records, was it Goodbye Yellow Brick Road by Elton John?
That was the first album I bought, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. I was probably 8 years old, and I heard Benny and the Jets on the radio. And
like, what's this?
Yeah, I know. It was just like, wow. And the album, when I got it home, you know, you open it up and it was like a trifold double album, and it had a drawing or a picture for every song. It was like a big comic book with all the lyrics written out and, you know, told who played what instrument and, you know, what's an arp and what, you know, what's the difference between a piano and an electric piano? I mean, it was so exciting. I just immediately became a record fan. I was the kid who was, you know, once I was old enough to walk from school to the record store after school, that's what I would do. I wouldn't hang out with the other kids. I'd walk to the record store and just thumb through the stacks and see what was new and what the record covers looked like and who it said produced the record on the back. And I mean, I love them.
It was all just this big magic world to immerse yourself into. Did the people in the record shop recommend anything to you?
Usually they just wanted me to get the hell out.
He's back again.
I didn't buy a lot of stuff. I just sort of thumbed through. I mean, eventually when I got older, when I got into high school, you know, I could get a little bit of help from them. But when I was a kid, no, I knew what I wanted. I didn't have too much money. You know, I was really young. So mostly I just go and look at stuff and imagine what the stuff sounded like. But slowly but surely, I started buying my own records. I mean, I bought all the Elton John records from the 70s, basically, you know, from Empty Sky all the way through to Blue Moves. That was kind of my obsessive period for Elton John. I'm pretty sure I could probably sing along with every one of those songs still. But then, you know, I got into a lot of different things. I got into prog rock. I got into Steely Dan, and I got into the blues a little bit too. There was once we moved to Idaho, I was probably seven or I guess I was 8 years old when we moved to Boise, Idaho.
How was that as an eight-year-old kid?
I was pissed off. I was really, I was yeah. really upset because LA to me, my grandparents, they lived there. So I used to drive around with my grandfather all over LA. He would take me to these amazing places. Like I went to Disneyland once every 2 or 3 weeks. There were all these amusement parks and I had a really close relationship with my grandfather. So moving away was hard. It was shocking. However, once I got there, I realized I could ski. I could go anywhere and not, you know, get into any trouble. I could, you were pretty safe, a lot safer in Idaho than I was in Southern California. Yeah, it was all right. Once I figured out the lay of the land, I didn't mind it so much.
Were you seen as the California kid when you started at your new school?
I definitely was. I stood out. My hair was longer. I wore funny clothes. You know, I just didn't quite fit in. I learned, strangely enough, you know, I went from Southern California, from a town called Whittier, California. That's where I lived before we moved. And that ended up being kind of part of the gang culture, that town. There was a big gang problem there. When I was there, I didn't have any of that. I moved to Boise and I had to learn to fight. I got in a fist fight every other day. I mean, I haven't been in a fight in a very, very, very long time, but did get into a lot of scraps because I don't know, there was just this kind of strange thing. I was the outsider and so I got challenged a lot.
Kids are ruthless.
They are pretty mean. Yeah. And there's, I guess, about that age, about 8 or 9, that's when, at least in my experience, that's when they really kind of got tough, started being cruel.
You're known for singing, guitar, obviously saxophone. I see that in the background. But I believe you originally wanted to be a drummer, right?
I started playing clarinet when I was about 9 or 10. And then I started playing drums the year after that. I mean, I still have a drum kit and I play occasionally, but I've never really. Occasionally on a record, I'll play some percussion or something.
Who was your guy?
As far as drummers? Well, there were a lot of people. I mean, I just played along to any record I could get a hold of. I mean, I played to a lot of Led Zeppelin records. You know, I'm not certain that I really understood what John Bonham was doing. I mean, only now am I looking back and thinking, good God, the way he played that fill was just amazing. And the way he swung, you know, I mean, I suppose that really did get me, probably didn't know what it was hitting me, but I really learned how a rock and roll drummer could swing. That's something he really did. So I listened to a lot of them. Nigel Olsen as well, you know, Elton John's drummer. I thought he was great. I still, when I listen to those records, it's such smart pop rock drumming. Really cool.
Because didn't you play in some punk rock bands during high school?
I did.
What can you tell me about that?
Once I got older, yeah. I mean, we were We were cover bands, you know. I mean, I played in three or four new wave punk rock cover bands. We'd play some originals, but I didn't really do any of the writing. I just played loud and hard and fast. You know, that was...
You got to throw some band names at me. What were the names of some of your early bands?
Well, the first one I was in was called The Effects. And I didn't name that band. They spelled it A-F-E-X.
Had to be an X in there.
Terrible idea. And then I left that band because I joined the Commonauts, not Cosmonauts, but Commonauts. And we made a single, actually. We recorded a single. And then I left the Commonauts to play with a band called the B-Sides. I think those were basically my three new wave or punk rock bands. We played the Stranglers and the, you know, the Sex Pistols and also U2 and Elvis Costello and Joe Jackson and, you know, kind of generally the second English invasion stuff, you know, everything from pub rock to punk rock and in between.
Any of those guys still around Boise?
I think the Commonauts had a reunion not that long ago, but I didn't get involved.
Was you going to see any bands live yourself as a fan?
Back then, not really. When I was young, I didn't really get out to see concerts. You know, occasionally, I guess in high school, I saw some cool things, but we didn't get a lot of great stuff. If we got stuff, it was kind of lower level. I mean, I saw John Lee Hooker play. I saw Stevie Ray Vaughan. I saw Robert Cray. I saw a lot of blues artists. For some reason, there was a good supply of that stuff. Saw some cool jazz, Joe Pass, Leo Kottke, the great guitar player, Pat Metheny. I saw Sarah Vaughan. I saw a lot of jazz, especially because there was a jazz festival up north in Idaho, up in Moscow, Idaho, at the University of Idaho. I saw Ella Fitzgerald, George Shearing. I saw Bobby McFerrin, a lot of really amazing people. But that was more in high school. I guess I did get to see a Pretenders concert right after the big comeback record. I saw Chrissie Hynde at her peak. I mean, she was incredible. Not that she's peaked. I still think Chrissie, oh boy. So the dogs are going to bark now.
I'm normally used to that in the background of mine.
It's just fine. So you know that you're gonna have some barking on your show today.
What was your first encounter with Gene Harris, who I believe instilled like a real love of jazz in you?
Yeah, Gene Harris was a blues, soul, and gospel influenced jazz pianist who was a legend. He was a really inspirational and influential jazz pianist in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. He recorded for the Blue Note label with his band called the Three Sounds. In the mid late 70s, Gene retired temporarily anyway, and he moved to Boise, of all places. He was this big, barrel-chested African-American man, just a beautiful black man. And here he was in this little town in Idaho, just a really white bread place, didn't know anything about jazz. But he started playing weekly, you know, five nights a week at this club in town just to keep playing, even though he'd retired. He was done with the touring and making records for now. And so he played at the Idaho Hotel in the lobby bar of the Idaho Hotel. And I found out that on Tuesday nights, he had a jam session, an open jam session. First time I went down, I just watched from the corner. He played in the lounge, which happened to be part of the lobby of the hotel. So you could, as a kid, even though kids weren't allowed in a bar, you could sort of be on the periphery of it. You could still be right there, right next to him, because you were in the lobby of a hotel. And I went in and heard it and thought, well, I could probably come in and bring my clarinet in and play. And I started coming in and playing my clarinet and then eventually my saxophone. I mean, he was a legend of jazz, playing for free in a lobby of a hotel in Boise, Idaho, at that time, there were only about 90,000 people in Boise. It was still a very small city.
Did you know anything about him, or did you just see this guy like, this guy is amazing?
No, I'd never heard of him. You know, I mean, I was still pretty young that I didn't know that much about jazz anyway, you know, but especially someone, he wasn't like a Dave Brubeck or a Miles Davis. He was a name that all jazz musicians knew, but maybe not, he wasn't a household name. So I went in just thinking, all right, he's really good and he's really nice. He was really warm and inclusive, and he let anybody play that wanted to. And at the end of the night, he'd say, yeah, baby, you sound great. Come back next week. I'm sure I sounded like hell. I'm sure I just was making god-awful noises with my horns, but he was so nurturing. He was a good man.
Did it give you confidence?
He did. And he gave us, you know, my friends and I, he gave us advice. I would say that Gene had he had a lot to do with why I'm a singer rather than a saxophone player first. You know, one day he took me aside, he'd heard me sing something. And I didn't usually sing at the jam sessions, but my buddies and I sat in and one night and I did sing a song. And he took me aside and he said, you know, you're a good saxophone player, but hearing you sing, that's your thing, man. You're a really good singer. You should pursue this. And so that was a big moment for me. That really changed my direction. And, you know, since then, I've been a singer who plays saxophone. I play sax, but my strength really is as a storyteller, as a singer of songs.
Did you stay in touch with him over the years that followed?
I did, yeah. Sadly, Gene died way too young in 2000. He died of kidney failure. He was waiting for a kidney that was delayed because his daughter found out she was ill. And anyway, he passed. But I was friends with him till the day he died. I lived in New York by then, but he had created a jazz festival called the Gene Harris Jazz Festival. It was a big festival that happened here in Boise. And I would come back every year and play. And I sang on a couple of his albums as well.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, so it was like coming full circle to have grown up with him. Then I had my hits, my pop hits, and toured the world and, you know, had lots of success. And then got to sing on a couple of his records. And that getting to sing on his records was every bit as big as any of my own success. It was really exciting for me. Very, very, very moving.
What led you to move into New York in the late 80s? Was that simply just to further your career? You felt you needed to get out of Boise? And
yeah, I knew so many musicians that I played with in bands that were older than I was, who were bitter, who were unhappy with their lot in life. I could tell that the music thing had let them down. They still played music. They were still great at it, but they didn't make records and they, you know, they weren't on TV. They didn't sort of reach the heights that they had wanted to. And well, I wasn't thinking, I got to make records or I got to be on TV. I was just thinking, I don't want to end up pissed off. I want to grow. I love playing with these guys, but I bet if I move to a big city like LA or San Francisco or Seattle, I'll meet better musicians and I'll get better. I'll learn how to do this thing. And I checked out those places and I couldn't really figure out how to fit into those towns. I didn't know where to go in any of those places, but a friend of mine invited me to join him when he went to New York City. He was working. He was on a business trip. And so I was able to crash in his hotel room and I saw New York City and that was it. I was like, Jesus, this is for me. New York is, even though it's the, you know, the biggest city in the States, it's all compacted. You know where everything is. It's not spread out like an LA or I knew exactly where I would go. I didn't have to have a car and I just loved it. I mean, it's just New York, even now, you know, and it's mellowed out considerably. It's not nearly as fun as it was then, I would say, but it's such an amazing place. There's so much going on. So I fell in love with it. I went home back to Boise after being there for a week, after being in New York for a week. I went home, I put together a band that I knew could make a lot of money quickly. And a year later, I had enough money to move to New York City and I split. I took a bag of clothes and my saxophone and I hopped in a car with my friend who was driving east. He dropped me in New York City.
You drove cross country?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I figured that was, I thought that was actually a good way to start. I mean, for me, it was just like, well, it's free.
Bonus.
There'd be room for my stuff. It was an old buddy of mine who was going back to college on the East Coast. And so we drove for, I think it took us 4 days to get there. And
how cool was that driving into, well, I guess you're in Manhattan.
It was unbelievable. Yeah, we drove across the George Washington Bridge.
Like the opening scenes from a movie or something like that.
It really had that. It had that vibe. It was really amazing. It was like, oh, here I go. Let's do this. And I swear to God, I had a bag. I had a duffel bag of clothes and a saxophone. And that was it. I had a place to stay for a couple of months. There were a couple of nice people that let me use the extra bedroom in their apartment for a little while. And then they said, you've been here a couple of months. It's time to find an apartment. But I just started going to, jam sessions. I've never been really a jazz saxophone player. I'm a blues saxophone player. I'm a rock and roll saxophone player. And so I went to the blues clubs instead of the jazz clubs, because I knew if I went to the jazz clubs, I'd get annihilated. I'd get murdered because it's New York City. It's the best musicians in the world, or for jazz anyway, are right there. So I went to the blues clubs where a saxophone player was quite appreciated. It's like, wow, a guy's here playing sax. Cool. And no matter what, every time I went to a jam session, by the end of that jam session, I'd been offered a gig with somebody else next week or in 2 weeks or whatever. I'm playing in such a place. Come play sax. I'll pay you $50.
Was you offered like any kind of recording stuff, like to come and guest on people's demos or songs like that?
Not really. No, the recording stuff, I didn't really. I mean, I suppose eventually people started saying, yeah, you know, would you come? But for the most part, it was just live gigs. That was what I was shooting for. That's what I knew. Back then also, you know, recording was expensive. Not too many people had home recording stuff. Now, you know, you can record an album on your phone, for God's sake. But back then you had to have gear. You had to go into a studio. And so there wasn't quite as much of that. I was just playing clubs in the village, mostly in the East and West Village, in Greenwich Village, New York. And it was blues. And I would go play with this band and the singer would run out of songs after 3 hours that he knew. And I'd say, well, I got a few. So I would step up and I'd sing a few songs. Then the next day I'd go back and talk to the owner of the club and say, remember me last night? I was the one who was singing at the end. I have a band too. And that's how I just kind of hustled, got more and more gigs and met more and more musicians. And I started getting phone numbers for musicians that I'd heard on records. You know, I mean, the people that I played with, the people that I paid $75 to play blues songs, totally improvised at crappy blues clubs that I'd heard on record. I mean, the lists are amazing. Harvey Brooks from Electric Flag and Miles Davis's Bitches Brew. A bunch of the members of Suzanne Vega's band I played with. I mean, it was really cool. They all lived there. It was New York City. So the people that I got to rub elbows with as this young punk that just showed up with his duffel bag and a sax, it was fun. It was a blast.
Was you writing a lot of your own material then?
When I got to New York, I wasn't a songwriter. When I started playing with these New York musicians, they started saying, some of them started saying, you need your own songs. That's what artists do. They write songs or they get songs. I was like, oh yeah, I guess that makes sense. Okay, how do you do that? And so I'd make an appointment to go see my buddy, the guitar player. Mark Shulman was one of the first guys I wrote with. He played with Suzanne Vega for a while. And I'd just go to his apartment and we'd knock out a song and I'd go home and finish the lyric and come back. And I've always been, for the most part, a collaborator as a songwriter. I've written a lot of songs. Most of the songs that I've written with other people. And I think it just helps me, if nothing else, just to have a deadline. You know, it's like if someone's waiting for me to finish a song, I feel guilty for not finishing it. Whereas I've got dozens of songs sitting here at home that are not finished.
There's no deadline, no pressure from someone.
Exactly. It's like it's just the embarrassment of not having them.
You figured that middle eight out yet?
Yeah, exactly. It's like, I got it. I mean, a lot of times I finish that middle eight on my way to the session, you know, to the songwriting session.
When did you feel there was suddenly a buzz? Because you started to get quite a lot of label interest. I guess that was the time where once one label started hanging around, others got wind of it.
Yeah, they were giving record deals out like chocolate candy. You know, it was like, it was pretty great. It was a good time to be there. This was 89. I evolved. I started in the blues clubs. Then I started writing songs. And so then I started playing in some of the more showcase pop and rock clubs, including the Bitter End, which is a famous club. It's still there. I mean, lots of people have made albums there. Randy Newman made a record there. Donny Hathaway made, I mean, so many people played there. But it's just this tiny little club, kind of a singer-songwriter club. And people would do their little showcase shows. And I started getting a little bit of notice from young A&R people, kind of the junior A&R people, but they weren't the kind of people that could give you a record deal. They could just sort of talk you up. But at the same time, or in that same period, sort of, you know, a couple of years after I moved to New York, I got a gig playing at a restaurant on the Upper West Side, West 79th Street in New York City. It was called Wilson's Restaurant. And it was just this big, kind of pretty pink pastel yuppie place that, you know, was in a nice neighborhood. And they had pretty good food and a fancy bar. And basically every Sunday night I played there with this little jazz trio. We got a free meal, all we could drink and a little bit of money. And that was great. And that's where I was playing a mixture of the types of music that I've always loved. I was playing with a jazz trio and we were playing some standards. We were playing Duke Ellington and Charlie Parker and you know, the standards, Gershwin's and Cole Porter songs and Irving Berlin songs. But we were also playing the occasional Steely Dan song, the occasional Donald Fagen song, the occasional Big Joe Turner song, or the, you know, we played an Elvis Costello tune. We played a Tom Waits song. So I was kind of doing then what I do now. That's the kind of records that I have made for the last 20 years. I take modern pop songs by modern writers, and I take them apart, put them back together as a jazz, in a jazz arrangement. And that's what we were doing there just for fun. And because we got, you know, to drink free B-52s at the end of the night. It was like a good gig for a starving musician. And I met an A&R person there. I met someone from a record label and she introduced me to a lawyer because she wanted to give me what they call a demo deal. She wanted to give me some money so I could write some more songs and make demos of it. So she introduced me to a lawyer to do the deal. That lawyer came to see me and said, you need to get a record deal. You're beyond it. You've got songs. People are going to go nuts for what you do. They're going to like what you do. And so he wrote out this plan. He said, well, I'm going to bring this person and that person and this person from all these different labels. And he did. Every week, a new head of A&R or big A&R person would come to my show. And here we are, you know, we're doing this because we got a nice free pasta and some Bass Ale. And here, you know, at one point, Clive Davis, the president of Arista Records, came in, you know, because it was all planned out. And it was really wild. By the time I signed my record deal, which would have been sort of late 89, yeah, probably late 89, I signed. signed it, or maybe it was 90. Anyway.
How long had you been in New York then at that point?
I'd been there for a few years. I'd been there for 3 years. So it was probably, it was 90. It seems like I was there for 10 years. I mean, I played so many gigs. I worked so hard. I rode so many subway trains at 3 a.m. You know, I mean, it felt like I'd paid my dues for 20 years.
You'd earned your Warriors waistcoat. Going on the subway.
I felt like I paid some dues. You know, I mean, my first record came out when I was 25. I wasn't a kid. I wasn't 18. Like, you know, I took my time at least to learn how to write songs. And so anyway, I signed the deal in 90 with Arista, with Clive Davis, and set out to write some more songs. I got to meet some amazing people. I met Glenn Ballard. I wrote I Wonder Why with.
He pretty much had the pop music covered at that time with like Michael Jackson, Paula Abdul, and Wilson Phillips.
Yeah, he was hot and on the way up. Kind of the next thing he did after me was meet Alanis Morissette, and he ended up producing and co-writing her big record, which changed pop music forever. You know, I mean, thanks to Alanis Morissette and Glenn Ballard, when I came back with my second record 3.5 years later, which was way too long, and we can get into that, but pop stations didn't exist anymore. You know, it was alternative stations, which, you know, I loved those stations. I listened to those stations, but I just couldn't get on them.
Yeah, how'd you plug yourself into those? The whole landscape changes so fast.
It does, yeah. And that was the thing. I made that first record. I had hit songs. It was great. And then I had a 3.5 year battle with Clive Davis at Arista, because he wanted me to, instead of record my own songs like I had on the first record and find my way as an artist, he wanted me to cover other people's songs, you know, big middle of the road pop songs, work with kind of the big middle of the road producers and go that way. Go the Whitney Houston, Taylor Dane, the thing that worked for him the best.
Was that easier sell for him in his eyes, do you think?
I think that's what he thought. Yeah, I think he thought, well, you know, this is my... It was his, it was the way he did it. It was like, plug this into this with this and do a bunch of promo and make a super expensive video. The thing is, though, he put out a lot of those records and only a very small handful of them broke. You only hear about the Taylor Danes and the Whitney Houstons, but I knew a lot of artists on that label who did exactly what he said and disappeared after an album or two, because it doesn't always work. You know, it doesn't. And I wanted to at least be able to look myself in the eye and say I made music I loved, rather than, you know, I made music because some guy in a suit told me it was going to be a hit. That always worked for me. When I was young, I played music that I loved and I made a living doing it. When I got a record deal, I wrote songs that I loved. I picked both producers, Glenn Ballard and Danny Korchmar. You know, I helped to pick the players. You know, it was who I was at the time. The next year, it sounded too slick to me, you know. But when I made that record, that's where I was. Then I was being told that I shouldn't follow my heart, that I shouldn't sound the way I wanted to. I should sound the way somebody, you know, a marketing guy thought I should sound. And that didn't make sense. So I basically... By battling Clive, I dismantled my pop success. I said, all right, this is the thing that's important to me. My music, my artistic soul, that's what's important to me. The other thing, having pop hits, I think I can do my thing and people will buy it. Well, by the time that second record came out 3.5 years later, all that momentum that I had from a big hit album, a big hit debut album was gone. And so I kind of had to decide, you know, where to go next.
But it would bring you to the UK. And was it Wembley Stadium you played? It wasn't Wembley Arena.
Yeah,
Wembley
yeah.
Stadium opening for Elton John. How did that, because that's like another full circle moment for you, I guess.
It was amazing. Yeah. I opened for Elton John, Eric Clapton, and Bonnie Raitt.
Pretty solid lineup.
Yeah, no kidding. You know, all three of whom were just heroes of mine. And then me. It was amazing. 3 nights, Wembley Stadium, you know, 88,000 people. I got to play saxophone on the bitch's back with Elton John all 3 nights. You know, I mean, it was mind blowing.
Is there any footage of that?
Just photos, unfortunately. Yeah. I mean, it was before everyone had a camera, you know, in their phone, you know, I mean, I would love to have video of that, but no, unfortunately not. I bet it's somewhere.
There's got to be something.
Somebody has a VHS in their basement.
Well, I would imagine Wembley Stadium, they had screens, right?
Screens, yeah.
Yeah, so someone recorded something somewhere.
Someday.
Yeah.
Someday after I'm dead, they'll find it. But yeah, that was amazing. I ended up playing Shea Stadium in New York and Dodger Stadium with them as well. It was they were heady times. I mean, the people that I got to open for to support that year. I mean, I supported Prince in Dublin. I supported Rod Stewart in Glasgow, and I supported Joe Cocker in Paris.
Ticking every box.
It was crazy. It was just all these people who I'd grown up learning from and listening to, and here I was opening for them, and in most cases getting to meet them. I didn't ever meet Joe, and I chose not to even ask to meet Prince. When I opened for Prince, I just felt like, you know, I want him to stay Prince/God in my head. I wanted him to just be a deity, you know, not to be a guy that either didn't want to meet me and treated me like crap, which, you know, I mean, sometimes you're going to run into that. Or worse, if you'd have been like, oh, hello, Curtis, how are you? It's like, no, I wanted him forever to be love sexy. You know, I wanted him to be Prince, and he will forever be that.
I love that. And you have a career-spanning new album, This Life, which features reworkings of some of your best-known material, but it takes its name from the Sons of Anarchy theme song. Could you tell us a little how that originally came? Because you worked with that on Dave Kushner from Velvet Revolver, right?
Yeah. I was very lucky. Bob Field Jr. is an old friend. We've written songs together since the mid-90s. Bob gave me a call, it's 13 years ago or so, and said, I got a new job. I'm the music supervisor for this new TV show, and I've just written the theme song with Dave Kushner from Velvet Revolver, and we want you to write lyrics for it. Do you have some time for that? I said, oh yeah, I'm off the road. That's great. What's the show about? And he said, it's about gun running, bloodthirsty bikers. And I said, well, no wonder you called me. Because yes. You know,
I'm your guy.
I'm a total biker. So I wrote lyrics that kind of reflected that idea. And I saw the trailer for the show and it looked cool. And I wrote some lyrics and I sent back a demo. You know, they sent me the music. I sang the lyrics that I'd written, sent it back. Bob said, yeah, this is great. The creator of the show, Kurt Sutter, wants to, you know, tweak some of the lyrics and add a few things. And I said, sure, it's his show. Go ahead. Send it back to me. He'd, you know, kind of co-written the lyrics with me. And then I sang it again, sent it back. And Bob called and said, they love it. They want to use this. And I was thinking I was just going to be a co-writer. I didn't think I was going to be the singer of the thing. So I ended up getting to be the voice of Sons of Anarchy, at least the theme. And I ended up singing several songs during the series. Bob would call me and just say, we've got this. We're doing this. I'm sending you the music. And I'd pop into the studio for an hour and sing it here in Idaho and send it back to him. It was funny. And it was a lot of fun. I mean, the other thing besides This Life, the theme song, which is on the new album, in my live band version, I mean, the reason I set out to make this record the way I did with these old songs is because these songs sound different than they did, entirely different than they did on the original records. We do them as a jazz quintet, not as, you know, a big pop 90s band or a hard blues rock band like the Sons of Anarchy thing. But anyway, I got to sing John the Revelator for that show, for Sons of Anarchy, which is a great old Sunhouse blues gospel thing, and many more. It was a lot of fun, and it helped quite a few people that maybe wouldn't have listened to my music discover me. They'd come to my website. First, they'd go, how is this guy? You know, I mean, it's always been my blessing and my curse to be versatile. And I do a few different things, and sometimes it's confusing.
Was you a fan of the show?
I was, although it was pretty rough. I mean, it was brutal. There was a certain point where I did check out. I have to go back to it and finish it because, I mean, I know what happens, basically. I know the story.
Wonderful ending to it. It ends perfectly.
It was Hamlet, right? It was Hamlet on motorcycles.
The show had such a rabid fan base. I say, it must have brought so many people, you to their attention.
It's amazing. People love that show. And it's not, you know, it's not bikers. I mean, I'm sure there are plenty of bikers that like the show, but it's like school teachers and bank tellers. And I mean, it's amazing.
Such great storytelling though. That's, people are invested in those characters.
Yeah. And really good actors. I mean, all of them were so great. It touched a nerve. It grabbed people.
And on the new album, you've also got a new version of Keep Me From the Cold, which is another song you wrote with Glenn Ballard. Can I ask, is the new video for that a direct tip of the hat to the original 90s video in the way it's shot?
I didn't plan on it. To be honest, the new video, I made three videos in one day. In November, early November, I flew to Berlin. We needed promo photos and three videos in one day. We did them all in one day. By the time I shot that video, I think I'd had at least a few glasses of red wine. I don't remember what we were thinking. It was mostly just the photographer had three or four really nice tableaus. He had really nice spots. And then we just filmed it. Because I think the video for the original one, for Keep Me From the Cold, there was an actor and an actress in it. Back in the 90s, they always wanted to have a big story. And
that nice orange filter to everything that came out.
Yeah, exactly. And they always wanted to spend $20,000 more on your video than they did the last one. I mean, I always tell the story of making videos in the 90s. It was like, I wonder why it costs $100,000. The director was British. He said it was going to be like this, this, and this. When it was done, it wasn't this, this, and this. It was nothing like that. And then I went to the next one and the director was British. He said it was going to be this, this, and this. And it wasn't. And it cost $20,000 more. And so by the time my fifth or sixth video came around, it was amazing what they were spending. I could make 10 records on what we made a video for now, you know. And now I make videos with my, you know, with my iPhone.
They do 3 in a day.
Just put my dogs in it and that's it.
I just thought it was interesting. I thought, oh, I'm going to go back and compare it to how much it's changed from the original. And I thought, like, the framing on you and
that's funny.
The
wow.
Delivery. It's like, oh, is this kind of like just a little tip of the hat?
I haven't seen it in so long. So I'm going to go back. That would be funny if it was just accidentally. I mean, clearly we did. We obviously accidentally made it like the old video. Yeah. The 90s are back, baby.
Yes. And you're returning to the UK next month. You're doing a residency at Ronnie Scott's for a few dates, then a full tour in March. What do you look forward to about coming back to the UK after all this time? Do you have favorite places to visit outside the venues? Is there much opportunity for that?
A pub. Proper pint. Give me a pint of real British ale as soon as possible. And then take me to a curry. Take me to the good local.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I love Britain. I love England and Wales and Scotland and Ireland. I love coming over there. I've been coming over for 30 years now. It's the place I've toured the most and spent the most time. So I have friends. I have so many friends that I haven't seen in 2 years because of the pandemic. I mean, just going around and playing music for people is something that I've missed incredibly. I mean, I do my kitchen show. I have songs from my kitchen that I do every Wednesday. And that's been my connection to my fans for the most part for the last 2 years. And so getting out and playing again, I'm really, really looking forward to it.
Well, enjoy that pint when you come over.
I shall. Thank you.
Thanks ever so much for talking to us, Curtis. I've loved it. Best of luck with the new album and the upcoming tour.
Thanks. Good to talk to you. Far out, man. Take care.
'Cause I have wandered through the mountains. I have searched the streets below, but all I ever really wanted was someone to need me and to keep me from the cold. I have wandered through the mountains. I have searched the streets below, but all I ever really wanted was someone to love me. I want you to love me and keep me from the cold. Baby, keep me from the cold. Keep me from the cold. You're all I ever wanted. Baby, keep me from. Keep me from the cold.
Big thank you to Curtis Stigers for being an absolute gentleman and sharing such great stories here on the Straight to Video podcast. That was a real treat and I hope you enjoyed it too. For all the information on the new album, This Life, along with the full list of UK tour dates, be sure to visit curtisstigers.com. And if you want to listen to over 150 more episodes of this show, they're all to be found at stvpod.com or wherever you listen to podcasts. You should be able to find us everywhere. That is all for today's show. Thanks for the great support you continue to show this podcast because it never goes unnoticed. And until we speak again, take care and let's do this again soon.